friends, now let's start with a new topic called as Java annotations, which we come across while working in the NetBeans IDE or Eclipse IDE and so on. And whenever we are trying to make use of the servlet programs, most of the times we see doGet method, doPost method and everything, and there we come across these annotations. So what are these annotations basically? So annotations come from the class called as java.lang. And in the java.lang, we see that we have many classes, something like object. Inside that, we have all the data types. Then we have the string, we have runtime, we have math, number, process, string buffer, system, thread, and so on. So along with that, we have even a package called the java.lang package, in which we have the java.lang.annotation, which support, or I can say, provides the library support for Java programming language annotation facility, which I'll be telling you a little bit later. Then java.lang.instrument provides the Java programming language to work with the JVM, which we have already discussed. Then java.lang.management works with for managing the interfaces for monitoring the JVM, which works during the runtime of our Java environment. Then java.reflect provides the classes and interfaces for obtaining the reflective information. So in this particular package, java.lang package, we see that we are coming across java.lang.annotation. So what exactly is annotation? So annotations are nothing but a form of metadata where we provide data about a program that is not program itself, but they give the code a different meaning. Something like, annotations have no direct effect on the operation of the code, they annotate. It is something like when we are writing the comments, then the comment also doesn't have any effect upon our code. Similarly, even the annotation also doesn't have any effect upon the code, but it really gives some information to the compiler that the following code is having some meaning with respect to that particular annotation. So annotations have a number of uses, that is information for the compiler. So they can be used for detecting the errors or suppressing the warnings for the compiler. And during the compile time and deployment time also, software tools can process the annotation information to generate code or create XML files and so forth. And whenever we have some runtime processing, then the annotations are also examined during the runtime. So we will see how they are doing this job in our programming. So how to create the annotation? So annotations are similar to interface, but they have the @ of sign. Then along with that, they make use of the parenthesized list of element value pairs. So the elements will be of any basic data types, and we cannot use any user defined data types. So the basic data types like string, integers, float variables, character variables, we can use only those pairs. So the methods can also have the default values. So here, let us see the syntax of it. So first we have the access specifier of that particular annotation, then @ of symbol, then interface and the annotation name. So this is how we are going to declare one annotation. So inside that we have the data type, let it be string or whatever it is. Then the method name, if I want making use of any method, then I use the method name and the default value if the method is particularly present inside that particular annotation. So this is a little bit optional, but the parameter whatever we are using, it should not contain any throws clause. That is, it should not have any exception whenever we are trying to work with it. So let us see one example of how we are trying to create one annotation. So here we are using annotation called as pub request for enhancement with access specifier and @ of interface, then int identification. So this one identification is the integer, then abstract. These two are the methods with the data types. Then we have the operator and default is unassigned, and here string date, which is unimplemented. So like this, we are trying to create one annotation. Now, by default, every annotation automatically extends the annotation interface. For example, if I use @ of classic, then we don't need to extend the annotation jar file, or annotation is a superclass for all the annotations. So here we don't need any extension. So here the value name of the annotation is this one classic, and it is having one variable or method called as text, which is having the default value as nomi, and uni is one method which is having the default value as 224. And whenever we have this text and uni, then inside this classical method, before this is getting executed, I am warning the compiler that this particular classical method may contain txt and university with the nomi and 224 as the values. Then that is how we were creating the user-defined annotation. But most of the times we don't do it, and most of the times we are trying to use the things which are present already inside the JDK, and the JDK provides us with the built-in annotations. So built-in annotations which are used along with the Java code to tell the compiler that this has to be done. So we use override, suppress warnings, deprecated annotations. Then the built-in Java annotations which are used in another annotations are target, retention, inherited, and documented. So these are the seven main important built-in annotations provided by the JDK. So we will see one by one. Now how they are exactly written. So Java dot and lang dot annotation. Dot annotation is the superclass, and for that all we have the derived classes in the form of suppress warnings, override, deprecated, and so on. Then let us go with the first type of annotation called as retention. So retention annotation is used to specify to what level annotation must be visible inside our program. Now example to specify the retention policy. Now let us see the retention policy. So here we have dot source refers to the source code discarded during the compilation. It will be available in the compiled class. Then dot class refers to the dot class file available to Java compiler but not to JVM. This will be available to only source code. Here it will be available to dot class file but not JVM. Then runtime, this will be available for the Java compiler as well as JVM. So this shows the retention policy. Retention is to what extent that particular annotation must be retained inside my program. So here we are using a retention policy, retention policy dot runtime, that is it is needed for the JVM, and the target is element type dot type, which is the annotation. So this is one annotation, element type dot type, and this is the retention policy, and the target for this retention policy is element type dot type type of annotation. So here we are using at the rate of interface my annotation int value 1 and string value 2. So this is how we are going to specify the retention policy for this my annotation type for the element type dot type. Next, we are using one more called as documented. That the rate of documented marks the annotation for inclusion in the documentation. So whenever we write the code, we also make use of the comments. We have the comments like a single line comment, double line comments in the documentation comments. And whenever we want our code also to be documented, then we make use of the at the rate of documented marks, so that whenever the compilation is being done, then even the documentation is also done along with it simultaneously. Then we have inherited. So whenever we are inheriting anything from the to the subclasses, then we use the inherited type of annotation. For example, here we are considering one for everyone as one interface, that is annotation. It will be available to subclass also. So for everyone class, superclass, class subclass extends superclass. So here whenever I'm using at the rate of inherited for everyone, then this interface will be available for even the subclass also. Means the sub superclass can be extended, otherwise it cannot be extended. Also in normal core Java programming we don't see this when we are working with the Notepad and everything. But when we are using the IDEs and all, we need to make use of this at the rate of inherited annotation. So similarly, there is one more called as override. So we see overriding the methods many times inside our programs. So let us see here, we are using animal. Here we use one method called as eat something, and here we are using dog extends animal. Then eat something is already written here, but I'm trying to write it again here. So what exactly happens is I'm trying to override the method which is already present inside the superclass. So to say the compiler that I'm making use of the overriding, I use the override as the symbol to specify the compiler that I'm making use of overriding of the method. So the code goes something like this, where we are just trying to override the method and get the output. Next we have deprecated. So deprecated annotation marks whenever we are using let us say Java C command, then we find Java C along with the input and output statements inside our program. When we are using data input stream or buffer reader or java.io type of things, then we see it is having a deprecated API, something like that. So it informs the user that it may be removed in future versions because of some errors. So whenever I am using at the rate of deprecated, then it just warns the compiler saying that this can be ignored in the future versions of our program because it may give rise to some errors. And similarly, we can even suppress the warnings of our program during compilation by using suppress warnings. Then we have the last one called as target, where we can specify the target. So the element types will be type, class, interface or enumeration. Then field, we can specify it to fields. Then we can specify it to methods, we can give it to constructors, we can give it to local variables, we can give it to some another annotation type as well, and also we can give it to one parameter as well. So whenever we are making use of this target, then we specify the target annotation how must work with. So we have seen the retention annotation where we were using the target. So in that situation, what we did is at the rate of retention, then we gave the retention policy, then at the rate of target, and we gave the element type as type. So here we are giving the element type as type, which can be given for the interface called as my annotation. So here we are specifying the target. So when I am using this target, then we are using any of these element types. So here at the rate of interface, my annotation, here I am making use of the element type dot type, and the int value and the value 2 will be affected whenever I am using the my annotation along with the target. So this is end of our annotation chapter.